let's talk about this wild tale about alligators being dropped into the deep sea and the crazy creatures that showed up to munch on them. Picture this. It's February 2019, and a ship is cruising through the Gulf of Mexico, acting all kinds of suspicious. It's sailing along, then it just stops, like it's taking a breather. Every time it pauses, it drops something big into the water. At first, you might think it's just some random junk, maybe a chunk of wood or something. But nope, when you zoom in, it's way more jaw-dropping. They're tossing alligators into the ocean. These massive reptiles, tied up with ropes and weighed down, are sinking straight to the ocean floor like some kind of creepy underwater piñata. What in the world is going on here? To figure it out, we need to talk to the mastermind behind this bizarre operation. The guy calling the shots is Craig McLean, a marine biologist from University of Louisiana at Lafayette who's all about studying the deep sea. Now, the deep sea is no joke. It's like the Wild West of the ocean, dark, cold, and not a lot to eat. Food is so scarce down there that animals are spread out like stars in a big, empty sky. Studying life in that kind of place is tough because there's just not much action to observe. But there's this one magical event that shakes things up, a whale fall. When a whale dies and its carcass sinks to the bottom, it's like a buffet opening in the middle of a desert. All sorts of deep-sea critters come rushing in, sniffing out the meal. For scientists like McLean, catching a whale fall in action is like winning the lottery. These events are super rare, and finding one naturally at depths of thousands of meters is like trying to find your lost phone in a giant pile of laundry. Even with fancy remote-operated vehicles, it's a long shot. Back in 1992, a scientist named Craig Smith from the University of Hawaii had a lightbulb moment. He was like, why wait for a whale to die when we can make our own whale fall? So, he took a stranded gray whale, towed it out to sea, and sank it on purpose. Boom, instant deep sea buffet. The data he got from that was pure gold, showing how all these weird creatures behave when they get a big meal. It was such a hit that other scientists started copying the idea. They didn't stop at whales either. They started sinking all kinds of stuff. Sea lions, seals, cow bones, turkeys, even chunks of wood. It's like they were throwing a potluck for the ocean floor, testing what kinds of critters would show up to the party. These experiments helped them learn about things like bone-eating worms, which are exactly as creepy as they sound. So, against this backdrop, McLean had a wild idea. He's in Louisiana, where alligators are basically the state mascot. These alligators were causing all sorts of trouble, overcrowding rivers, wandering onto roads like they owned the place, and even crashing golf courses like uninvited guests. Sometimes, they'd get into fights with humans or even start eating each other when food got tight. The state had rules allowing officials to take out the aggressive ones, so McLean thought, why not use those alligator carcasses for science? He got his hands on some from law enforcement and decided to sink them into the deep sea to see what would happen. I mean, an alligator fall? That's next level stuff. What kind of discoveries would come from this? They set up underwater cameras to catch all the action, and let me tell you, it did not disappoint. McLean had a few guesses about how this alligator drop would go down. Whale carcasses are soft and break apart easily, so their smell spreads fast, attracting scavengers like moths to a flame. But alligators? They've got this tough, armored skin, like a natural suit of armor. It's like trying to crack open a locked safe. McLean figured it might take longer for the smell to get out and draw a crowd, especially since they were dropping these gators at depths of over 2,000 meters, where life is pretty sparse. He was also super curious about who'd be the first to break through that tough hide. Maybe a shark? Chomping down with those razor-sharp teeth and doing its signature death roll to rip things apart? Or maybe hagfish? Those slimy, eel-like weirdos that love burrowing into carcasses to slurp up the insides? But hagfish might have trouble with the alligator's thick skin, so it was anyone's guess. The answer came faster than anyone expected. In less than 24 hours, the first guests showed up to the alligator buffet, and they were not what McLean predicted. No sharks, no hagfish. Instead, these creatures looked like something straight out of a sci-fi movie. They were giant isopods, these funky armored critters that look like oversized roly-polies you'd find under a rock in your backyard. Except these guys are the size of basketballs and have a vibe that says, don't mess with me. Their official name sounds like it belongs in a monster movie, Bathylomus giganteus. These dudes showed up in a flash, like they'd been waiting for an invite their whole lives. Within a day, 8 or 9 of them were crawling all over the alligator, tearing into it like it was Thanksgiving dinner. What makes giant isopods so impressive is how fast and efficient they are. Most deep-sea scavengers, like sea cucumbers, move at a snail's pace, taking forever to reach a food source. But giant isopods? They're like the sprinters of the deep sea. Despite looking clunky with their hard, segmented shells, they can swim pretty fast thanks to their 7 pairs of legs and 5 pairs of abdominal flaps called pleopods, which help them paddle through the water. They've also got a killer sense of smell, picking up the faintest whiff of food from miles away. Once they got to the alligator, their 4 pairs of powerful jaws went to work, slicing through that tough skin like it was butter. They exposed the ribs, burrowed inside, and started chowing down like there was no tomorrow. It was clear they weren't leaving much for anyone else. Why are giant isopods such eating machines? It's all about where they live. The deep sea is a tough neighborhood. Food is so rare that when something like an alligator or a whale hits the ocean floor, it's like winning the jackpot. These isopods have to eat as much as they can, as fast as they can, because who knows when the next meal will come. It's like when you're at a buffet and you load up your plate because you're not sure when you'll eat again. This survival strategy is tied to something called deep sea gigantism, where creatures in the deep ocean grow way bigger than their cousins in shallower waters. Think of giant squid or those massive Japanese spider crabs with legs longer than your arms. Bigger bodies mean they can store more energy, so they can go longer without food. Giant isopods are the poster children for this, gorging themselves to the brim to prepare for lean times. If you've ever seen a pill bug, you know those little roly-polies that curl into a ball when you poke them? Giant isopods are basically their jacked-up cousins. They're both crustaceans, like shrimp or crabs, even though pill bugs look more like insects. Fun fact, giant isopods have another weird relative called the tongue-eating louse. This tiny nightmare crawls into a fish's mouth, cuts off the tongue's blood supply until it falls off, and then replaces the tongue, living there like it's no big deal. It's the only known parasite that swaps out a host organ like that. Talk about a horror movie plot. While pill bugs and tongue-eating lice are tiny, maybe an inch or two long, giant isopods can stretch up to 50 centimeters, almost 2 feet. That's like comparing a grape to a watermelon. These isopods aren't just about eating, though. They're tough as nails. There's this clip from a 2015 Shark Week episode where a giant isopod latched onto a shark's face and just wouldn't let go. The shark was thrashing around trying to shake it off, but the isopod was like, "Nope, this is my ride now." Eventually, the shark gave up, and a whole gang of isopods swarmed in, turning it into a feast. It was like watching a zombie movie, but underwater. Funny enough, in aquariums, giant isopods are chill with humans. Some places, like Japan's Toba Aquarium, even have touch tanks where you can pet them. They're probably so calm because they're well fed, unlike their wild cousins who have to fight for every bite. Speaking of aquariums, there's this famous giant isopod in Japan nicknamed Number One. This guy made headlines because he stopped eating for 5 years, from 2009 to 2014, and nobody could figure out why. He'd just sit there, refusing food like a picky toddler until he passed away. Scientists were stumped. Was he sick? Depressed? Just not hungry? It's still a mystery. That kind of stubbornness shows how tough these creatures are, surviving in an environment where food is a rare treat. People have mixed feelings about giant isopods. Some look at their big, shiny, triangular eyes and hard, Darth Vader-like shells and think, "Nope, that's an alien." Others find them oddly cute, like a quirky pet you'd want to hug. In Japan, they're practically celebrities. You can find giant isopod pillows, phone cases, even little toys in those gachapon machines you see at arcades. Their bodies are built for survival, 7 pairs of legs for crawling and grabbing food, 5 pairs of pleopods for swimming and breathing, and a brood pouch where females carry some of the biggest eggs in the invertebrate world. They can't eat much while pregnant because they're busy protecting those eggs, which makes them even more hardcore. Now, here's where things get weirdly delicious. Since giant isopods are crustaceans, like shrimp or lobster, some folks in East and Southeast Asia have tried eating them. Apparently, when you fry, stir-fry, or steam them, they taste a bit like shrimp or crab, with a similar texture. But don't expect to see them at your local seafood market. They are super hard to catch, usually showing up as bycatch when fishermen are targeting something else. Plus, breeding them is a nightmare, so they're not exactly a hot commodity. The biggest ones, like the ones at Toba Aquarium, usually come from Central America, while the Asian species are a bit smaller, maybe 30 centimeters or so. At the end of the day, giant isopods are like the ocean's cleanup crew. They swoop in, gobble up whatever's dead on the seafloor, and keep things tidy. Without them, the deep sea would be a messier place. So, maybe instead of thinking about eating them, we should just let them do their thing, cruising the ocean floor like the ultimate scavengers they are. McLean's alligator drop showed us just how incredible these creatures are, turning a weird experiment into a front row seat to one of nature's wildest shows.